Hello, my soccer universe. Slightly different perspective today because I decided to take a different sitting for this video reviewing everything from Spain, France and Portugal. I actually waited until the round in Portugal was finished and then turns out there was a makeup game in La Liga as well. So totally makes sense to do this now. And yeah, I don't know if when I will do the next one, but I'll try to cover you. I decided to wear my PSG third jersey from last season. A, I love it. B, PSG headline now number one won Le Classique. So rubbing it a little bit because I'm definitely coming down on the Paris side of the French divide in a way. If you ask me, you know it, I have been in the 90s a PSG supporter. I'm a little bit disillusioned with the whole Qatar thingy, but you know, old loves die hard, they say. So yeah, that's definitely. Also, yeah, the rearranging back there is a whole lot of white here. Because I decided what's the use if I continue with Sevilla where the Atletico Madrid away jersey is and then with Valencia there when you cannot really see them, so we have to put them here, which I am not too happy about, but you know, we'll deal with it. Hope you like the jerseys back there. I am working to get something else, but only Benfica for the Portuguese section there. Working on that one, I hope soon to get the other big two. So headline number one, you got headline number two. Let's go to Spain, where both, at least on the weekend, Real Madrid and Barcelona got a little scare and got away with it. Real Madrid actually having a non-convincing but very successful 6-point week in a way. And as we will see, since Atletico Madrid did not get a win, Real Madrid kind of slowing. Is there a chance? I don't think so. But you know, it looks much better. We talk about France, where I mean everything on top stays the same. But we had, of course, a big clash, and Monaco is probably joining the party there as well. And then in Portugal, I think we can really say Sporting another big favorite, as Porto twice cannot win. And in the second game, even throwing away a win while Sporting gets another 6-point week. And Benfica, so and so. I would say we gotta start, and let's start in Spain. No better place to start than Huesca Real Madrid. I saw the second half, and I have to say the second half was really, really, really fun because at the beginning was all Huesca, who twice hit the woodwork, and in between Galan with a great goal makes it 1-0 Huesca. To be fair, I mean, Real Madrid was the better, more active team in the whole game. However, that six sequence there really got me excited, and probably most people excited, because you know how often do you see a big team faltering, and Real Madrid is kind of this prime candidate because they are sort of out of the league, and they probably now put everything to, yes, you want to do top four, but and Champions League. However, Varane gets the equalizer, which was a very, I think it was Benzema hitting a free kick onto the crossbar, and then Varane pushes it all over the line. And Varane very late on actually gets also the winner. His first double scoring effort for Real Madrid, and so they get the deserved win. It has to be seen, but there was a slight chance for an upset there, which is always exciting. Villarreal is starting to worry me. There was, I think a month ago, I said, I really need to get a Villarreal jersey. You know, it's in my top 10 of jerseys again. It still is there. However, I really thought they can be a little bit better, but they're making way too many draws. And this is where the challenge for the top four will fizzle out. They had a great first half with Paco Alcaraz assisting Moreno in the 16th, and then Moreno making a second one. And that Alcaraz, I mean, he could have taken his shot himself and could have passed it over. I have to say, Villarreal has a really, really talented team. I don't know why they're not managing draws. And here again, they throw away the game because Elche, who was a no-show in the first half, come back and Carrillo and Boyer get the equalizer. And that's where it ends, and you really feel, I feel a little bit bad for Villarreal. Sevilla against Getafe, this was interesting. First of all, Ocampos, I think, scored a good goal and was still ruled out by VAR for handball because we couldn't really realize whether the ball hit here or hit here and so on. I actually think the goal looked quite fine in the 35th minute. And then, yeah, every... Gomez, was a really... Dakonam with a really rough challenge onto Okamka Campos, where he steps on the foot. It was not on purpose, but it was every little bit of a red card. And Ocampos, who is kind of the live wire for Sevilla, if he plays well, Sevilla usually does well, he needs to come off, and he will be off for a few weeks now. And that seemingly irked Lopetegui so much that he got in a sideline fight with Bordalas, and both coaches were sent off. Once it calmed down a little bit later, Munir El Haddadi gets a really nice goal, assisted by Jordan. Then another goal is this allowed for Enesiri, and late on Sevilla makes it rather clear. I mean, against a 10-man team, with Papo Gomez getting his first goal. Yes, it took a really wicked deflection. So, but it looked nice on screen until you see the bad deflection it took. But I think with Papo Gomez, Sevilla, watch out. And then Enesiri a little bit later gets also his goal, and it's 3-0 Sevilla. Real Sociedad also back on track with a first win in a long time. Oyarzabal scoring the first two, especially the second one, how he wrestled himself over Cádiz, through the Cádiz defense, was pretty impressive. Then Marcos Mauro is sent off for Cádiz just before the half. Yeah. And then it was easy for Real Sociedad. Isak adding two more. So we have two double scorers. Very late, Izquierdo in the 65th. Very late. Makes for one, but this is where the game ends. Bilbao Valencia play out an interesting game. I think was a rather even fair with San Martin. With an own goal, gives Bilbao the lead just behind, but Gabriel Paulista can equalize. For me, the most interesting thing was after the game, when all the Valencia players went up to Marcelino, the coach of Bilbao, who of course was not too long ago their coach and was a very popular coach, just not for Peter Lim and whoever is taking care of Valencia. And they all, he was... They all loved it. It was a love fest right there. Ed with the Valencia coach has a Bilbao background. It was a very surreal scene. This is not something you see that often. Quite the opposite. We see quite often that Betis against Barcelona. This is, I mean, when it's on, you should watch Betis Barcelona because goals are guaranteed. I heard yesterday, I think in five games they scored 41 goals. I mean, it's incredible what these two sides are doing. But I have to say, for the first, when Messi wasn't playing, then De Jong, I mean, Koeman clearly putting all his marbles in the bag for the cup tie against Sevilla coming up tonight, we'll see. So he saved a lot of players like De Jong, Pedri, and of course Messi. And Barcelona didn't look good. Araujo had to come off, and De Jong then came on in the 12th. And it's still, Barca needed a little bit of a spark. And in the end, Iglesias gives a 1-0 lead at the halftime for Betis, which was fully deserved. However, second half, in the 57th, the little guy comes on. And in the 59th, he makes it 1-1. Typically Messi goal, I have to say. And just about 10 minutes later, one of the craziest own goals you will see. I mean, slapstick in a way. Antoine Griezmann has free to pull it into net, but he hits it. And it hits, I think, his right leg. And then off his right leg, it goes back onto the left leg of Ruiz, who puts it into his own net. I mean... Absolute nuts goal in many regards. Ruiz makes up though for his miss in the 75th, gets an equalizer 2-2, and it looked like this is how it's gonna end. I have to say, at that point the game was even. Betis hanging back, but Barcelona seeming a little bit running out of ideas until Trincao comes with a wonderful shot. I first thought it was Messi because, I mean, watching only, I was looking away at the time for a sec. Yeah, bad on me. Great shot, and it's 3-2 Barcelona. Then on Monday we had many games in Spain. Atletico Madrid, Celta Vigo, and Celta actually showing up for the game, getting an early goal through Santi Mina. And I have to say this was a weird game because all the goals were kind of scored from crosses coming in from the side of the box, Atletico, yes, also not full squad. They are kind of looking a little bit depleted, like for instance, no Joao Felice. But before the half, Luis Suarez gets the equalizer of Marcos Llorente assist. And right after the half, Lodi again crosses it in. Suarez pokes it in the 50th. But Atletico cannot really hang on. And that's a little bit of an indictment on them, I have to say. And Ferreira, very late on in the 89th, gets the equalizer for Celta, and Atleti drops points at home. As we will see, they still have a very sizable lead. Yesterday, makeup game from round one of all rounds. Real beating Getafe 2-0. Rather, you know, it was not great, but they get the goals through Benzema and Mondi. And it was a game where Marcelo was playing and Real Madrid actually won. That's a rarity these days, but Getafe really not that great at the moment. So with all this action, we have Atletico Madrid still on top. Two games in hand. At the moment, it's a 5-point lead. Two games in hand. You can add six. It's probably an 11, but it's still very, very sizable lead there. The chances actually dropped. I think it was almost 80% a week ago, and now we're at 68%. It's still very, very comfortable. And you know what? I think Atleti is more fearing a Barcelona side that starts clicking than I think a Real Madrid side, although they have their number. I mean, the derby is usually going for Real Madrid. So we have to see, but it looks very much that Atletico Madrid is going to ride this easily home. Also, Sevilla is in touch with the top, big giants between Real Madrid and Barcelona. I think with the addition of Papu Gomez, maybe they can do something. Maybe they can do more than just getting top four. I actually think they could probably overtake one of the giants. With the game in hand, Barcelona not has a game in hand, so although they are now in third, in reality, they are level with Real Madrid. I also think that 5 and 6 are pretty clear. On the bottom, it looks a lot tighter, but it's Valladolid, Elche and Huesca who are the odds-on favorites to go down at the moment. If we adjust, you see actually how sizable. I mean, it's 2.6 points on average over 2.1 that Real Madrid has currently. And then, you know, Sevilla is kind of in there with Barcelona. But not much changes. And on the bottom, Valladolid, Elche, Huesca, it remains the same. We also should look at the expected standing because that's the most important in a way. How do we project forward? And especially if you look at the green shadings, Atletico Madrid very much on the champion side. Barcelona ahead of Real Madrid, 3 points at the moment. Sevilla in fourth. But I think that could be a little bit tighter. Real Sociedad and Villarreal on a dogfight for the last Europa League spot. And then kind of is the wall. I think everything from Betis down is midfield. Getafe kind of teetering in between. Could we go up? Could we go down? Maybe a little bit more on the downside. And then the last three, I can repeat myself, other ones that might go down. I already alluded to it. We have Copa del Rey semifinals, first leg. Why do we play it in two legs in such a full season anyway? Sevilla-Barcelona is the big one. I think as close to must-watch as you can imagine it to be. And Bilbao-Levante, I think, is also quite interesting as well. Fun times coming in the Spanish Cup. And on the weekend, not really the big game. I have to say, Villarreal against Betis is almost the one that intrigues me most. I mean, the big name is Real Madrid-Valencia. However, I don't expect necessarily a big game. Atletico has to play at Granada, tricky tie, Sevilla, Huesca should be an easy win, Barcelona, Alaves should be an easy win. So yeah, a lot of time on La Liga. So we have also another makeup, we have more makeup games. So on Tuesday and Wednesday, Levante and Atletico and Sevilla, Elche. It's crazy. We have many games. It might as well be that I make another huge video in a week's time from now. But let's see, there's so much happening that I might have to put one in before. In France, honestly, not too much happening. We had Lyon getting a relatively easy win over Strasbourg, who had a man sent off with a yellow red already in the 14th minute. I mean, those were two yellows within a minute. Depay, Ekambi with a really nice goal in the third, and then Depay again scoring the goals for Lyon. Nîmes against Monaco was probably the standout result with Golovin scoring a hat-trick. He gets two goals in the third and in the 12th. Monaco has even a goal disallowed for offside. But Nîmes comes back and Deo and Ferrar equalize, and then they had even a chance to take the lead, but Monaco equally had a chance to take the lead before the half. After the half, Golovin with a great free kick in the 62nd makes it 3-2. Volland seemingly puts the game away, but Eliasson pulls one back, and again Nîmes could have equalized. So for a side that is on the bottom of the table, this was a rather lively and very, very interesting game for sure. Lille, rather easy. David, two goals against Nantes. Nantes, I think it's time to get rid of Dominic and get a proper coach in. I mean, it cannot be with such a clown on the sidelines. And what can I say about Marseille PSG? Marseille actually took the game a little bit to PSG. But on a corner kick, they're called on a counter where Di Maria sends Mbappé, and who puts it in the internet. Yeah, that was a typical Mbappé goal, and I really, really liked it. However, on that pass, Di Maria kind of injured himself. He had to come off. Marseille still having more of the game, but Florenzi with the cross, and Icardi with the back of his neck kind of loops it over Mandanda in the internet. I think a good goalkeeper might have saved that one. And it's an easy win there because super efficient, and the game kind of fizzled out and it was sort of boring. Of course, there had to be a red card. Payet with a really, really rough tackle. Again, I don't think it was necessarily intended, but it was a rough tackle and every bit of a red card the way he hits. Was it Verratti into the hips? Looked ugly. Looked absolutely, absolutely, absolutely ugly. So, as I said, not much changed on top in France, except that PSG's chances keep a little bit dwindling because Lille and Lyon keep the pace up and PSG is still a little bit behind, although still very much the favorites to win that title. On the bottom, it's now Nantes with Lorient winning. Nantes really, really, really in trouble. And as I said, I would love to both Lorient and Nantes, but I really have a soft spot for Nantes and it hurts me to see it. As I have for Nîmes, Crocodiles. I love Crocodiles. You know this by now. Adjusted table win. Yeah, Marseille would move up, but I have my doubts. I mean, if they keep up their performance against PSG, they could, but I have my doubts that they would really move all the way up into six ahead of a really great last side this season. In the expected standings, as I said, PSG ahead of Lille now, and then Lyon, really, really interesting there. Monaco kind of set on a fourth spot, but I actually think Monaco could challenge. And then Rennes in, Marseille more or less out. And on the bottom, Lorient, Nantes with a slight advantage now for Lorient, thanks to a three-point cushion. In the league, we have a weekend round. PSG Nice, I mean, is early because of the Champions League, of course, against Barcelona. Lyon against Montpellier, I think, could be a tricky matchup. Rennes against Saint-Étienne, just at the beginning of the season. This was the top of the table clash. Saint-Étienne has fallen steeply. Lille against Brest should be easy. And then Girondin Bordeaux against Marseille. That's a classic. Two jerseys I have right hanging here. I need to get at least a little jersey, if not a Monaco jersey as well, for back there. So yeah, I'm working on it. Don't worry. Because we also need to talk about Portugal. There are also a lot of things happened. Porto, only a 0-0 at Belenenses. They had a goal. I mean, I saw a bit of the game. They had a goal disallowed by Evan Nielsen, but I think the whole thing then fizzled out. I mean, Porto not really creative, and at the end there was a bad, two players collide and the ambulance needed to come. It was kind of ugly at the end. So yeah. Of course, Porto tried, but couldn't. Benfica also only a 0-0 over Guimarães, and Braga beating Portimonense at the same time, and Sporting winning at Maritimo. So I just give you the table from there on, and then we'll go a little bit more detail. Sporting distancing themselves from Porto, Braga, even overtaking Benfica for that little time being. It's kind of the halfway point of the season at this point, although there are a few games in hand. We'll adjust a little bit later. And everything, I think, from spot nine on, it's so tight that whatever happens, there's always a lot of changes. It's actually rather tedious to prepare these tables. And what was to follow? Porto against Braga. Porto had an easy 2-0 lead. Penalty by Sergio Oliveira, and then Taremi with a wonderful Corona assist. It was a similar goal to what Sterling scored against Liverpool. Sets Porto easy on the way. However, Corona, who had two really rough challenges, gets sent off in the 60th. Braga has a really hard time, doesn't create many, many chances, but you know, with some patient passing in the 87th, they get a goal through for Ferran Sergio with more or less their first real chance of the game. And then stoppage time, Gaetan makes the equalizer, and that really puts a damper in Porto's hope, because Benfica, within 7 minutes, is 2-0 up and rides this home against Famalicão, the surprise side from last season. And Sporting, yesterday evening, found themselves down at the half to Gil Vicente, but turned it around, but very late in the 83rd, Coates, and in the 91st, he again scores. And so we have Sporting flying high, 8 points clear of Porto. It seems really, 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 really good for Sporting at this moment in time to break the duopoly between Porto and Benfica. Although in Portugal, I think it was always almost all, but I think one or two championships have been won by the big three. So yeah, if we adjust for tables, it's especially Passos and Guimarães have one less, but you know, it doesn't really change much. But we see how Sporting is outperforming the expectations. Porto and Benfica slightly below, and Passos and Guimarães also good. Braga pretty much on track. Expected, look at the relative strength. I mean, Sporting has not the highest rating, but they are very much now the favorites. I mean, 5 points on average ahead of Porto. Benfica also then 4 points behind Porto. It's a bad, 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 bad season for Benfica, one has to say. So yeah, we have also the Portuguese Cup coming up with quarterfinals, Braga-Porto. They just played, so will be interesting. It's the first leg, of course, and then Estoril Benfica is the other one. That might be the one where both Porto and Benfica put all their eggs into that basket, because Sporting is so far away. Sporting has to play against Ferreira, Porto against Boavista, so we have a derby, and then who is Benfica playing? Playing Moreirense. Yeah, we have to see. Should be an easy win, but with Benfica this season, you never know. So, very, very long video. I hope you enjoyed it. A lot of information packed in there. I know three leagues is always a lot to cover. Give me a thumbs up, enjoyed this video. Drop a line below if you want to add anything. Subscribe to my channel if you want to see more videos like these, and I will talk to you soon. Bye. Hey there, I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, here are some videos and playlists that you might give interest to you too. Also, please consider subscribing to my channel to give you all the updates, all the things that rotate in my soccer universe. And with that, have a great day.